And I appreciate your taking time from very busy schedules. I know everybody is busy, so I appreciate your taking the time to be here. Well, let's get started. The what I should do here. Okay, so the college has been very involved in sustainability education in one form or another. If it weren't not only in the classroom, it was outside in terms of one thing we see, that our beautiful new building. We've had sustainability detergents being used. We've had recycling taking place. We've had many different aspects of conservation taking place. But one of the key areas, obviously, that I'm involved in is thinking about the work to be done in the classroom. Just to let you know, if you don't already know, BCC is a member of the American College and University President's Climate Commitment, which is an organization comprised of, I think, about 600 colleges and universities now. And every now and then, the presidents of the colleges and universities have to send in a report as to what kind of new sustainability efforts have been made on the college campus. And we also, in the last 4 years, have become a member of the Community College Affiliate Program, which is part of the National Council for Science and the Environment, which is a Washington, D.C.-based organization. And it has, the whole focus is bringing community colleges together and working on sustainability education. How can we promote that within the community college system? So a lot of what I'm going to talk today about is my journey. Not so much the journey of the field at large, but my journey in getting into this thinking. I'm a sociologist, and before I started thinking about these issues, I was into globalization and trying to understand how first world countries get rich and how third world countries get poor and what that relationship is. So I basically was looking at the class system of the international order. And then I read a couple of things, I heard a couple of lectures and so forth, and my life changed and never was the same again. And so now what we have, I see that we have a five-pronged crisis facing humankind. Climate change and global warming, I think, is the largest one. Fossil fuel depletion, petroleum, natural gas, and coal. The non-fossil fuel resources, ores and minerals. Species extinctions, and you have an example here, and freshwater shortages. This last one is something that's really very new to me, and I don't feel very secure talking about it yet, but it's a critical issue that we're going to have to face. Here at the college, we have a green engineering program. I'm really happy to say that my colleague, Robert Rack, a few years ago, was able to get a $900,000 grant from the National Science Foundation and went about regreening a lot of the courses and developing new courses as well for the engineering program. So that's in place. The environmental science program has been in place for a while, and to be honest, I'm not even sure how that got started. Maybe Greg would have an idea of how that got started. But yeah. Okay, well, I don't know, but anyway, in the agriculture program, which is basically a permaculture-based program, was started by James Corvin. We worked very hard several years ago putting together our first efforts in trying to have an agriculture program, and it's a sustainable program in terms of the kinds of teaching that takes place. And then we have our new program, which goes through the liberal arts arena, Sustainability Studies Concentration. And we originally wanted to have a standalone Sustainability Studies program, but we were encouraged by Greg to do it through the liberal arts so that it would go quickly through the state of Massachusetts. Otherwise, we might have to linger there for several years and maybe still never come out with this major. So the idea is if we get enough students over time, we then can go to the state and say, yes, we have a major that looks very viable. We already have so many students in it, and we would like to have it as a standalone major. So the beginning of my journey really begins with peak oil. And I don't know, does everyone know the term peak oil? Everyone have an idea about what that means? Okay, so, and when I'm talking about peak oil, I'm talking about specifically conventional oil. That easy, bubbly up oil that, you know, you see in the old sitcoms, Beverly Hillbillies, right? Yeah, where it's bubbling up around their feet and so forth, and all of a sudden these hillbillies find themselves to be really rich. Well, I began studying some material on peak oil. And as you see, this is the U.S. oil production and discoveries. You can see that the discoveries are way, way past here. You can't really see. Can you see the timelines? Yeah, you can. I can't see them on this. But then peak oil comes up around this time, around the 1970s, 1980s. Actually, that got forestalled because of the 1974 oil embargo that took place. And so it got delayed until around 2010. But now we see that conventional oil worldwide is at 2010. And you can see here from this bar graph that the huge discoverable oil fields are long past. And again, for the conventional oil, we have less and less being produced. Right now, we obviously have fracking and the tar sands and so forth, which are really not sustainable forms of oil production. Okay. Here is a sample of some of the things made from oil. And if this looks like a confusing array of things, I put it up here specifically like this because it is. Everything from computer chips to trash bags to electric blankets to perfume to lipstick to house paint, et cetera, et cetera. And this is just the surface group of things that we have put together. The medical field depends on petroleum. And we see everything from antihistamines to antibiotics to the fuels that are used for ambulances and so forth. The medical field, which of course is huge in the United States, very costly, and we have a whole system that's dependent upon fossil fuels, a fuel that will be in decline in this century. So the next stage that I began thinking about was looking at climate change and thinking about how climate change really impacts people's lives. I had been thinking a lot about how fossil fuels had impacted people's lives, but this was really new to me. And I really only entered this maybe about 2 or 3 years ago. But these are some of the issues that we see with climate change. We have an increased frequency of storms. I think we're all pretty aware of that reality. We've had more storms. They've been greater in severity. I understand that today, in the southern part of the United States, there's heavy tornado warnings. And this is becoming the norm rather than the unusual. Increased floods, increased droughts, increased number and intensity of wildfires, as well as rising temperatures and heat-related deaths. So this doesn't sound like a very nice scenario, does it? The maximum CO2 parts per million that climate scientists have warned us about is not to go higher than 350 parts per million. And we now are just over 400 parts per million. So this means we're going in the wrong direction. We really should be going down from the 350. And actually, ideally, it should be around 275 to 300. But this is where we're at right now. So let's think about global warming impacts. And I just want to say that I had to go through all of this to really think about why is it important to have a social science-based sustainability program. That's what this is really coming to. You know, I'm not one of the hard scientists. I'm not a biologist. I'm not a physicist and so forth. And I had to think, well, you know, what does this really mean for society? What does it mean for how people live on a day-to-day basis? How are they impacted by these things? So it really meant having to go through a lot of these issues before I got to the point of thinking, oh, so this is what a program could look like. So that's what I'm really trying to do, is take you through this a little bit. Okay, so we see that we have Arctic ice melt, a decline in fresh water, accelerating sea level rise, coastal erosion, loss of human life, infrastructure and building destruction, infiltration of salt water into freshwater sources. This is a huge issue. Human population displacement and migration, loss of livelihoods from coastal tourism, decline of fish stocks impacting fisher people's economies, ocean acidification altering aquatic life, and species loss and decrease in biodiversity. These are all of the impacts. So I'm not going to go through each one of those, but I chose three or four that I thought would be most telling. Okay, if we look at recent storms from 2012 to 2017, these are major storms. These aren't small little storms. These are major storms that have had huge impacts on populations. Many people have died. Much destruction of property in coastal areas has occurred. And so you see in 2012, Japan, Great Britain, Ireland, Caribbean, and the east coast of the United States. And we can just go through this. Pakistan, I have friends in Pakistan, and I remember this period of time when they were going through the flooding. And we come down, and we see already in 2017, we're not even through March, and we've already seen a major flood in Peru and also one in California. And there's threats of serious tornadoes in the south right now of the United States.
I will add to that that even in Lima, where they are feeling the effects of the drought, the floods, and as this morning I talked to my parents, they told me that during this week they expect 3 days without water.
Yeah.
The whole city of Lima, we're talking about millions of people.
Yeah.
Very traumatic.
Yeah. It gets serious when there's not water availability. Mm-hmm. Right. Okay, so the severity of storms, if we just take for an example, Superstorm Sandy, which we experienced in this part of the world, the deaths, we had 117 in the United States, a total of 233 from the Caribbean up to the East Coast. Homes damaged, over 200,000, power outages, 8 million people were affected. Loss of business, huge. Cost of recovery, huge. So we have millions and millions and millions of dollars that get lost in business and the costs of recovery. And, you know, here's a couple of images from... This was taken down in Warwick. I don't know if you remember. Is anyone from Rhode Island? Does anyone remember the Warwick, the superstorm? It hit, this is from Superstorm Sandy, all of these photos. And at some point in the mall, this is from the mall, the Warwick Mall, the water was so high that it entered the second level, the second floor of the building. Okay, so. And this was...
I had eight faculty members lose their houses in New Jersey. Yeah.
Oh, really?
And we weren't even near the shore, but people had shore houses and lived out there in that community. Yeah.
Right.
In New Jersey, right?
Yeah, New Jersey.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So let's take an example in another part of the world, Pakistan. Floods covered, this was in 2010, the floods covered one-fifth of Pakistan. 18 million people were affected, nearly 2,000 people died. 12 million people had their homes destroyed or damaged. And look at this crop destruction. We don't think about the crop destruction, but look at this. 2.2 million hectares are over almost 5.5 million acres of croplands destroyed. Croplands means food. 10,000 schools damaged or destroyed, and 450,000 livestock dead. Okay. So these storms are having real heavy impacts on people's lives and on the land that they live on, and also on their animals. This is a picture from Pakistan. The flooding. This one is bone chilling. So, another gift that we get from climate change is droughts, okay? And let's look at the impacts from droughts. Loss of human lives, both direct and indirect. Loss of property and vegetation and animal life. Loss of animal habitations and debilitating dust storms. Land grabs. Does anyone know what a land grab is? Are people familiar with the dust storms, okay, in China and so forth, which has caused at a couple of different times a complete stoppage of everything? Nothing moved because of the dust storms. Land grabs refers to one country going into another country and taking land for agricultural purposes. And this is happening in various parts of Africa, especially by countries such as China and Saudi Arabia, some of the richer countries, where they have devastated their own land, and now they've gone elsewhere in Africa, which, by the way, is the poorest continent and can least afford to have that kind of invasion, right? These land grabs are going to cause an enormous amount of conflict. It already is causing conflict, but it's going to cause even more as time goes on. It's kind of bizarre to me that China would want to go to Africa to take up land to be growing things when we have a fossil fuel decline taking place, and it means that you have to be moving your food from Africa, which is not right next door to China. Right? That's like, you know, our expecting to have, you know, the 3,000-mile salad in the future, and that's an impossibility. Okay, and then we have societal destabilization and failed states, which I'll talk more about in a bit. Areas of current droughts you see here, and if you take note, at the very bottom we have the United States. These are current major droughts in the world. And if we look at this map, we'll see especially the West Coast. Now, of course, the West Coast, California, got a real deluge of rain recently. So presumably they're out of the drought scenario, but it's questionable how long that will take place, and they've been in the drought scenario for several years. So the impacts of droughts, obviously lack of water for human consumption, for agriculture and food security. It affects plants and animals, obviously, and in general vegetation, and especially forests. And it certainly increases the conditions for wildfires. Let me see. This is pretty. It looks like they're walking on stones, doesn't it? But this is parched land. And they're going to fetch water from somewhere. You know, in the developing world, women and children, but particularly women, spend many hours a day just fetching water. A farmer, not farming. And, of course, animal livestock. And we're seeing the same thing happen in the West in the United States, where there are ranchers who are losing their cattle because of droughts. And then, of course, we have wildfires taking place, which we've seen especially in the western part of the United States. And so heat waves, another gift from climate change, heat waves. Rising temperatures, and we saw the rising temperatures take place in 2003 in Europe. I happened to be in Europe that summer, and it was very hot. In Europe, 35,000 people died due to related heat-related conditions. In France, which is where I was staying at the time, 14,800 people died. And the temperatures reached 104 Fahrenheit degrees over several days. And of course, what happens is that vegetation is reduced by about 30%. That means crop yields and forest growth doesn't take place. It gets reduced. And I want to emphasize this. You know, I've learned so much going through this exercise, because not just for the putting this together, but in the process of putting together the major, I hadn't realized that, you know, plants have, you know, an okay point, like, I'm not going to grow anymore if it gets any hotter. And what they do is that they wither. And so think about what this means in terms of food. Okay, so this really reduces people's food security. And then we have excess farm animal mortality of 24%. And of course, the ecosystem absorbs less carbon. This isn't a very good image, but heat affects the human body. Human beings, the reason why there was such high death rate taking place in Europe was that a lot of people didn't have air conditioning, and a lot of people didn't have fans, and many people had some kind of illness that, when it was touched off by the heat, in fact, reduced their viability. And big fans, there were places where huge fans like these were put outside for people to go and just stand in front of, as well as people splashing in water. And speaking of water, we get to water. So water everywhere, but very few drops to drink. And this is going to be one of the major issues. Water, as some people have said, is going to be the blue gold of this century. Right? That about 70% of the Earth's surface is water, but 96% of it is saline. It's salt water. About 4% of the Earth's water is fresh water, but that's not all available to us. About 68% is locked in ice and in glaciers, and 30% in groundwater, 2% in vapor, rivers, lakes, ponds, and streams, and only 1% is where most of us get our water from. So out of all of the water that's on the planet, we have a very, very small sliver of that. Now, thinking back to glacial melt, you know, we've seen some large sections of Antarctic break off of up at Greenland. A few years ago, a sliver the size of Rhode Island broke off. And now there's a sliver about the size of Delaware that's in the process of breaking off. And this is a very big worry. This should be a very big worry for us, because what it means is reducing the amount of available fresh water. You know, when melting takes place with the glaciers in the springtime, the summer, and so forth, there's some ice melt that takes place. I'm not talking about the sections that have broken off and gone into the ocean, but it melts and it goes into the rivers and the streams and the estuaries and so forth, and it trickles down through the continents to our rivers, to our places of water. When a piece of ice breaks off, what happens to it? It goes into the ocean. And what kind of water is in the ocean? Salt water. So this precious, precious resource that we need for our lives and for and other species, you know, plant and animal need for their lives, gets wasted by this cutoff into the ocean and becoming salinated. This is a huge problem, because what we're doing is we're decreasing that 1% of water that already is available to us. You know, if you wanted a happy story, it's not going to happen today. It really isn't. Okay. Countries overpumping aquifers. This is from 2012 data. There are many countries that are doing this. You see what the population size of these countries are. And we have many of them in the Middle East and some in, a lot of them in the Middle East, some in Central Asia. We see Mexico here. But what else do we see? The United States. In 2012, our population was 316 million. We're now at 118.9 million. If we look at the total number of people affected by overpumping of aquifers, it's about 3.5 billion people. 3.5 billion, which is a little less than half of the total world population. The total world population today is about 7.4, 7.5 billion and counting. Water can be desalinated. You know, there's a whole ocean out there. There's 70% of the, it can be desalinated, but it's a very, very expensive process. I was in San Diego a couple of summers ago, and that was the time when they were introducing their desalination plant, and people were all excited about it. But when you look at this, this becomes very cumbersome in terms of how it's going to be paid for and so forth. The estimated output is 50 million gallons a day. This is one of the largest desalination plants in the country. The technology is by reverse osmosis. The cost to operationalize, huge, right? Huge. The percentage of water supply, estimated at 7% of San Diego County. And here the population of San Diego County is over 3 million. So when you're talking about $1 billion for a relatively small portion of a population, this money begins to really add up, right? This is an interesting issue, the issue of failed states. Is everyone familiar with the term failed state? Okay. A failed state refers to a state, a country, that is unable to meet some of the basic requirements that's expected of a country. That they're unable to govern, they're unable to follow, to maintain a rule of law, to provide personal security, all of these things that we see here. This is an indication of a failed state. The Foreign Policy magazine puts out an index every year that has measures of failed states. And these are some of the measures that they have listed. Demographic, population pressures, uneven development, legitimacy of the state, and so forth. And then we have the top 20 failed states. Okay, I think it's interesting to note that a lot of them are in Africa. Here we see Syria, Haiti in our own hemisphere, Pakistan, Iraq, okay. Afghanistan. It's kind of telling, you know, after the trillions of dollars that have been spent in this part of the world, in Central Asia, that these countries are failed states. Okay, so if we look at a country like Syria, more than half of Syria's population has been killed, wounded, or displaced by civil war. This is an example of a failed state. If we look at the internal displacement of people, 65.3 million people, the refugee state is 21.3 million. This is from 2016 data. In Syria, we see Syria's pre-war population was 23 million inhabitants. And Syria is at 6.5 million internally displaced persons today, with 3 million fleeing to other countries, such as Lebanon, Turkey, Jordan. Look at this. I mean, 2.76 million people you have in a relatively short time coming into your society. How do you deal with food? How do you deal with water? How do you deal with housing? How do you deal with education? How do you deal with infrastructure? Right. And then, of course, failed states is the perfect breeding ground for the rise of terrorism. Right. And the key thing that I want to emphasize with Syria, which I think many people have not come to understand, is that the situation in Syria began around soil destruction. this was about 6 years ago now, where the prices of food really began to escalate. And the prices of food escalated because so much of the land, so much of the soil had been deteriorated over time, that there wasn't enough food for the population. So of course, when there's not enough food, what happens to the price of food? That price goes up. And so there was a real backlash for the Assad government for their policies in terms of agriculture, and that was the unleashing of the civil war. So what has taken place in Syria today, the horror that's taking place, really has its roots in the issue of soil and water and drought. And in 2008, we saw 20 million refugees worldwide. In 2013, 200 million. You know, I think about the Southwest, and you know, we talk about we don't want those Mexicans coming in, but what do we do when the new Mexicans want to come? The new Mexicans are part of us, right? And they're living in drought-ridden areas. What happens then? So how did we get into this mess, right? Okay, so here's how. Post-World War II, we had three major trajectories going on simultaneously. The first two are really, really important. Of course, we have CO2 emissions increasing because of industrialization, consumerism, industrial agriculture, and transportation. But the second thing, and as important, and perhaps even more importantly, is that we began the decrease in forestation. We began to degreen the planet, and as we were, emitting all of this carbon, we were degreening the planet. Well, guess what sucks in the carbon? Greenery. So at a time when we're putting more and more of this carbon into the atmosphere, we're also taking down the very elements that can suck in that carbon, get it into the soil where it does a whole lot of good, and keep us safe. What has happened is a good deal of that carbon has gone into the oceans, which has acidified the oceans and is causing havoc with ocean life. It's really anticipated there'll be no more cod fishing in this part of New England in the next few years. Also, forget about maple trees. Maple trees will be going further and further north. So in the process of all of this progress, we disrupted Earth's water cycle. This is really important. Keith, write this down, okay? This is really important. Okay. Okay. This is really important because, you know, we disrupted the Earth's water cycle. And by doing that, we have disrupted the Earth's carbon cycle as well. We're not sucking out the carbon in the way that needs to happen. So this is a water cycle table. I shan't spend time on this. You can take a look at some point. And my conclusion after thinking about all of these issues was, you know, the engineering technology for CO2 reduction is critically important. I don't want to underestimate that, but it's sure not enough. You know, we can have solar panels to the hilt. We can all be driving hybrid cars. We can have wave energy and thermal energy. We can be putting up these beautiful buildings as we have on our campus, but it is not enough. The fact is that the experiences that we're having with climate change today are the result of things that we did 15, 20, 25 years ago. If we stopped, if something magic happened tomorrow and across the planet we stopped emitting carbon, we would still continue to have global warming for many, many years into the future. Because what we're doing, what we did yesterday, is going to play out 25, 30, 35 years from now. And we have increasingly a larger population to play that out. Okay, so what you've all been waiting for. Rationale for a social science sustainability focus. Human consciousness and behavior must change. It's not enough to drive a Prius or to put solar panels up, but we have to change our behaviors. And so I got together a group of people, Jim Corvin, Mary Ropian, Eric Bourgeois, myself, and a couple of other people who came in and out. And we began talking about what would a major look like? You know, what would we do? I didn't want to, you know, do this alone. I didn't want to have to own it by myself. Other people have to own it with me, right? And so we just started mapping out what kind of courses should exist. So the very first one, Sustainability in a Humankind's Dilemma, Life on a Tough New Planet, already had been offered. I already had offered that. And I talked about in that class the problems and the solutions. But the problems are so huge that, you know, I was skipping and cutting and so forth. So we decided to have that be the problem. So this is one of a two-part course, actually, okay? The second part is the resilient sustainability, preparing for the future. So here we talk about the problems. Here we talk about what people around the world are doing. And I have to tell you, there are just some heartening, incredible things that people around the world are engaged in. I recently wrote something where I talked about a group of women in India who have become solar engineers. These people are illiterate. They've never learned to read or write. They never had been out of their villages. And they had an opportunity to go through some training to put up some solar cookery in their communities. And that's what they've done. There's some really remarkable things going on. And then sustainability from different perspectives, 12 faculty. This is a course that has run three different times. And it's a wonderful course. 12 different faculty teach it, right? And they teach sustainability from their disciplinary perspective. And the interesting thing is that I get back word from some of my colleagues in the class that they've learned things, you know, that they've learned things, they've put together material that now they're using for other courses themselves, okay? And then sustainable economics, the rise of the new economy. Obviously, our economic system is not a viable or sustainable system. And there was a lot of effort in different parts of the world to create a very different kind of economic system. Corporate capitalism has really gotten us into this grave, and we need to get out of it. And how are we going to do it? You know, I talked with my students the other day about the gig economy. You know, we see more and more people in the gig economy. How are we going to employ people in that kind of economy? So what kinds of exchanges can we have? And also, as we see more and more climate change events taking place and fossil fuel depletions and other kinds of resource depletions, it's going to be critical that we figure out another way of doing economy. Sustainability, human rights, and climate justice. This is a biggie. You know, we've benefited, the first world has benefited from all of these goodies, but it's the poorest people of the world who are going to suffer the harshest conditions, and that's already taking place. So this course focuses on what kind of human rights do we need to be talking about, and thinking about the realities of what's facing us, how do we change our lives in the first world to connect with people in the developing world? Because if we don't, we're going to have failed states. And as long as we're having failed states, guess what else we have? Terrorism. And then this last one, Civic Engagement Sustainability Capstone Project. This is a real thrill, I think, for students who have gone through the program now to have an opportunity to go out, to connect with an organization, and to be working to apply the things that they have learned, to really think about how to incorporate sustainability on a day-to-day practical basis. And then there were three new courses that were developed. The previous ones, most of them were new, but these were developed by someone else. And this was Engin Atase, the Eco-Literacy Education Society. And basically what Engin does in that course is to look at educational theory and practice and what kinds of eco-literacy can be developed in school systems and in among students to help them understand cultural issues as well as the biological issues of climate change and so forth. And then Science versus Pseudoscience, Mary Rapien is teaching that course this semester. It's a trial run. And I love this course, Science versus Pseudoscience, because we have an entire Washington, D.C. population who is into pseudoscience. Okay? And then, you know, our dear heart, Eric Bourgeois, who passed on several months ago, developed the course Environmental Sociology, where we look at the built environment and ecology. Now, what we decided to do was not only to have these core courses, but students could have choices into some other areas where they could get some training, some education, some information that could orient them towards certain kinds of work out in the labor market. So this is quite some time ago. These are the people I talked with to get courses established. And this, in this case, it was with Megan Abella Bowen with engineering. And so these are the courses that someone who chooses this track, the engineering track, would take. And then the environmental studies, Robert Rack, that would be these three. And health sciences, Deborah Ann Quanga, physiology of wellness, nutrition, personal and community health. These are really, you know, great courses, and they're important courses for people going into the health field. With sustainability knowledge. And then, of course, science, principles of ecology, coastal science, and oceanography. And then Jem Corvin with sustainable agriculture. And then water and water management, Robert Rack. So, you know, you get slotted into, you choose an area. And we have one more that's coming up now. It's beginning the process with CWCC, and that's hospitality. We originally wanted to have this in the program as well, but it hadn't gone through the state, so we couldn't introduce it into CWCC. Okay, so what students can do with this degree? Well, you know, there's so much. You see, sustainability coordinators, consultants, directors, waste reduction specialists, environmental responsibility analysts. People can work with school districts and systems, social service agencies, business and industry, hospital and nursing homes, community planning boards. And that's not to mention, I didn't put this down here, but that's not to mention, of course, you can go on to other colleges and universities. And right now, Eileen Shea is working with other colleges and universities to see about the transferability of this into environmental studies and sustainability. And then healing the planet. These are the things that we need to do to heal the planet. And this is what this program really focuses on, the kinds of things that we need to do. New urbanism, a new economy, a new human consciousness and behaviors, as well as these regenerative aspects. And everything that needs to be done is doable, but only when humankind develops the consciousness and behaviors to re-enter the space of nature.
I'd like the use of the word consciousness, because I think this whole thing is going to require a change, upgrade in our spiritual evolution relative to how we relate to each other, how we relate to the planet.
Yeah, absolutely. It has very deep spiritual roots. I haven't incorporated that, and we don't think a lot about that necessarily in academia. But it's something that I'm working with more and more and thinking about how to incorporate this without it getting religiosity, you know. But how do we through our hearts and through our spirits and our souls reconnect with each other and with the planet? You know, you look around today and there's so much destruction among ourselves, and certainly there's that destruction with the planet. And we have to have a real enlightenment, and it has to be soulful. Yeah.
Yes, could you share with us some examples from what other institutions are doing? Or you mentioned in your talk that you're aware of some great projects around the world, even.
Yeah.
For sustainability studies, would you mind sharing some that maybe?
Well, when I think about the projects, I mean about specific things that people may be doing around solar energy or around water, water issues and so forth. The thing that I should emphasize, and I haven't said that here, when I started doing the research to find out what's going on from a social science base, I found very, very, very little. There would be a course here and there. The only place I found was a community college primarily populated out in the West by Native American people. It was the only one that came even close to this. Everything else that I have seen has been either through engineering, environmental science, and increasingly through agriculture. I do have to say I'm happy to see more and more colleges and universities developing at least courses, if not programs, in agriculture. We're one of the few community colleges in the country that actually has a degree and a certificate in agriculture. And to my knowledge, now there, I do have to say there's a woman in Wisconsin. I met her in Washington, D.C. a couple of years ago. We were having a little race with each other because she was building something very similar to what I'm doing, and we shared information, but we were sort of running against each other who would get there first. I was hoping to make it for 2016. It didn't happen. She said she'd be on for 2017. I haven't checked with her yet, but so we can go head-to-head with them. But, you know, most of the time we don't think about what are all of the real human impacts, and yet, you know, it, as difficult as it was to get this building put up, it's easy compared with trying to get people to change their minds, to think differently, and to behave differently. You know, as difficult as it may be to get solar panels up and so forth, getting people to have a different consciousness is really, really very, very difficult. And the problem, so much of the time, is that you get disinformation. You know, that's why we really, Mary and I really talked a lot about this. We wanted to have a course where, to help students know, how do you determine what's real and what's not real? What's viable data and what's not viable data? What's outright lies, right? I don't know if you remember this book called Lies, Damn Lies, and Statistics, okay? Well, this is from a long time ago. I'm showing my age with this book, but, you know, that's what we kept talking about, that book, and, you know, how are we going to get people to really understand this is real? You know, nobody ever asks, you know, if you believe in cancer, right? Do you believe in cancer? No, you know that cancer exists. There's lots of evidence of cancer, you know. Well, we have climatologists from all over the world through the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change who have concluded, they haven't even known each other, but they've concluded with independent studies that climate change is a very serious threat to human existence, that it is increasing. To the point, by the way, and I wonder what the administration in Washington is thinking now about this, the military leaders in this country have said that climate change is one of the biggest threats to American security. You know, it's sort of like, hello, is anybody home? You know. Anyway. Yeah.
Simple question. In your presentation, you used the term climate change and also global warming more toward the beginning. Do you think of them as synonymous? Is it a political process? Why perhaps one term is being used more now than the other?
Well, people, and earlier on, people used the term global warming a lot more. And then it would be cold, and people would say, well, it's so cold. How can we be talking about global warming? But in fact, so that's why a lot of discourse now is around climate change. But global warming doesn't mean it's going to be warm everywhere at the same time. But if we look at the general weather patterns around the world and the temperature patterns, every single year since the year 2000, with the exception of 2 years, has been hotter than the previous. Let me say that again. Every single year since 2000, with the exception of 2 years, has been hotter than the previous. So 2016 is the hottest on record that we've seen. So in general, what we see, there is the global warming. Although in certain places, and I don't understand the physics of this, right? But there'll be variance in one place versus another. But in general, when you look at the totality, this is what we see facing us. To the point where, I don't know if you've heard, you know, I mean, a couple of years ago, I think it was in Iraq, the temperature reached like 121, 122 degrees Fahrenheit. I mean, how do you breathe?
And that happens very quickly. People die because
the
temperature spikes overnight.
And when you think of a place like India, right, millions and millions of people don't have electricity. So guess what else they don't have? They certainly wouldn't have air conditioning because that would be too expensive, but they don't even have a fan. You know, we think about, oh, how hot it is in July. Imagine having day in, day out, with the temperature rising, rising, rising. I mean, that's what happens. The system just shuts down. And it's not only the human system, but other systems. Plant systems shut down. And when the plant systems shut down, guess what that means for food production? When animal systems shut down, guess what that means for animals? Right, so, you know, we really, I really wish that I could be head of the education department in Washington rather than the person who got it. You know, because my first day, you know, the current president, on the afternoon of the inauguration, proceeded to take down the EPA material about climate change, and has also done so with NASA. Okay, I mean, I'm so upset about this. I really think that charges of crimes against humanity should be brought against these people. They are really playing with the lives, not only our lives, but the lives of the planet and the lives of future generations. This is unacceptable. And really, I've begun thinking maybe legal action should be taken, as you know, towards crimes against humanity. It's not just their lives; it's our lives. You know. Anyway, don't get me started. Yeah, go ahead.
I would just, I'm glad to hear that you mentioned the need for behavioral change, you know, in society, because, and I was just thinking from my field, from economics, from behavioral economics, sometimes there are many examples that when I read and I learn, for example, the fact that the other day I was learning that when car companies make their cars, the hybrid and the non-hybrid, the conventional cars similar, they don't sell, the hybrid don't sell. Mm-hmm. Because people want to not only care, they don't only care about the planet, mm-hmm. they care about showing that they care.
Right.
You know, it's a status.
Right.
You know? So if they're similar, it doesn't matter. They're really, so it means probably they don't really care. I mean, they can care, but they also care about the other part.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that should be taken into account. It seems like superficial, but it's really not.
Yeah.
And or the fact that, for example, people tend to discount the future and focus on the present, you know, as a behavioral trend, let's say.
Mm-hmm.
And so in that sense, if we learn that in the future that will happen, it won't really affect me right now because I'm focused on my semester, right? Or the budget for the year. I'm not really thinking about retiring, although I should, but it's not something that worries me that much.
Right.
As a trend, we tend to do that. So
right.
Also in that case, when we talk to students, I really want to tell them right now what is happening around them and around their communities, in
right.
their family,
right.
For his own behavior, just because I think it has more impact.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes than repeating what we know in the future, that
yeah.
will be very catastrophic
yeah.
results, but somehow that doesn't have an impact.
Yeah.
So just wanted to mention
yeah. that. I'm glad you raised that, because one of the things that we want to do in this program is to have students think and have hands-on experiences, like how are things, how are you being affected? Really think through, you know, what is the weather like today? You know, what are the gas prices? Of course, they're low right now. But, you know, to be thinking about what kinds of things are happening in your life that, in fact, reflect changes that are going on, whether it's in the economy or in the climate or in you know, justice issues, climate justice issues. Yeah, Keith?
I know you had said that a lot of the difficulty today, especially with persons that aren't educated about what we have to deal with now on the planet, is changing their minds. Now, in that, I think all of us here are in some form or another connected with the education system. Do you have any other information about how far young we're educating about this kind of stuff? Like, is it grade school, middle school, high school?
Like, yeah.
I know in a lot of high schools it's pretty mainstream.
Yeah, I just know anecdotal evidence. I haven't done any research to see what's going on. But I don't think there's as much as we would like to see happening in the grade school or even in high school for people to really have an understanding, young people to really be exposed to this. And thinking, for instance, you know, about the importance of biology. You know, I was thinking back when I took a course, which is decades ago now, I took a course in biology. Of course, climate change wasn't on the screen and so forth. But, you know, the water cycle, you know, what the hell, the water cycle? I have to learn the water cycle. Big deal. You know, without really understanding, really, you know, having it driven home to me, how important water. Like, you are not going to be here if you don't have water, you know. And I think that's what we have to really do in our teaching, is to bring it home, that this isn't just something on a page or on a screen to look at, that this, in fact, affects your life. It affects the lives of the people you care about. It affects the lives of the community. So, yeah.
I have a drawn-out question. What you said about the idea that we could all have solar panels and we could all drive hybrids and we could all do all these, you know, and, you know, make these kind of engineering technological.
All very important.
Yes, very important.
Right.
We could all do that. I believe this was one of the examples where you said across the planet we could all do that and it still wouldn't be enough.
Right.
So, and I'll disclaimer, climate change and sustainability are passions of mine too, so mm-hmm. I'm with you. But I have heard people hear things like that from other places, you know, politicians or whatever, and just be really, really discouraged by it,
mm-hmm.
and come right out and just be like, well, no, I'm not going to recycle, or I'm not going to do this, or I'm not going to turn my lights off, because who cares? Like, it's not going to, nothing's going to change for 50 years,
right.
or whatever. Like,
right.
I'm going to be dead, what do I care?
Right.
You know, or I'm just one person, and unless everyone's mind changes,
right.
nothing is going to happen.
Right. Yeah.
So what words do you have for someone who is in that mental state?
Oh, we have some wonderful words for those folks. And there's going to be a speaker here tomorrow afternoon who's going to spend 2.5 hours with those words.
Okay.
But the fact of the matter is, you know, if you'll recall, there are two key things that we did after World War II. We emitted more carbon and we took away the greenery, the very stuff that pulls carbon out of the atmosphere. It's really simple. We need to regreen the planet. That's what we need to do. We need to be pulling up pavement in places where it's not needed. The forests need to be reforested. We need to protect the grasslands. We need to protect the wetlands. Everything that needs to be done is doable, but people have to understand that it is doable. We need to regreen the planet. There's actually, you know, I only tagged on to this thinking about 1.5-2 years ago, and I got so excited with it because We're not doomed to extinction, right? I mean, when you hear all of this, you think, oh, we're doomed to... But the fact of the matter is, by regreening the planet, we actually can get a lot of that carbon out of the atmosphere and also relieve the poor oceans of all the work that they're doing in pulling in carbon, right?
How long would that take, Nancy?
Well, I have seen many videos and some studies that have been done, and it can take 10, 15, 20, 25 years. It's not going to happen overnight, but it can happen very, very well. The planet is quite capable of healing itself if we just allow it to. I mean, it's remarkable. There are some people out in the western part of the United States where the grasslands had been completely destroyed, right? And they reintroduced certain animal life and patterns of animal regenerative agriculture and so forth, and it's just lush and green now. I've seen areas in Israel, videos of Israel, where in Israel, desert, you think about desert for Israel, right? Okay, where there are permaculture, greenery, experiments that have been done, and it looks like the rainforest in the middle of the desert. But you have to know how to use the water. You have to know how to use water vapor. You know, when I go traveling around and I see farmers with these big sprinklers, it kills me. The leaves don't want to be wet. It's the ground, it's the soil, it's the roots that need to be wet. We need to have, you know, the surface hoses with holes, and we need to have other means of getting the water right into the plants. Spraying all over the place. Please don't do that if you have a garden. Please don't do that. Don't spray all over the place the water. You're wasting water. Get it right down to the root, to the bottom of the stalk. That's what wants the water. You know. So.
Thank you, Nancy, so much. And I know that we went over word a little bit, but it was a very interesting discussion, and I'm glad that we ended on a hopeful note.